So I'm here for this episode of The Vote by Aiden Goatley, who's a comedian, but also a former manager, retail manager, I guess is a...
Very much former.
Yes.
Right. Former, we've certainly put that...
Former known as.
Former known as that guy. Oh, that guy from Poundland.
And Pets at Home.
When I gig in Brighton, I can say to people honestly on stage, you may recognise me. And not for my comedy work, just for the fact I was the guy running the Poundland on the London Road.
Served them cat feed.
I served them cat food. I may have done that as well. Yeah. Or tried to sell them a hamster. Not in Poundland. That would have been wrong.
Yeah, exactly. So, welcome to The Vote. Anyway, so obviously, we'll go into your career, comedian career, shortly. But I know you've got some shows coming up, haven't you?
Yeah, I'm doing... I've got the Brighton Horror Fest is happening at Sweet Venues in the Duke of Wellington. That's happening now, starting now up until obviously Halloween. I'm doing a show on the 25th of November. And then Brighton-wise, because I tour all over, but Brighton-wise, I am MC at Comic Boom, the Comedia, in January.
Okay. But before that, so let's talk about how it all started, because I know you did a comedy course, but before that you were a manager, and I know you've got some good stories to tell, so maybe where did it all start for you?
Well, it all started... I was running... I was running a garden centre in Worthing, and I was doing, like, 70 hours, driving my wife nuts, and I need... You know when you need something? And I'm sure it's got absolutely nothing to do with being middle-aged. I was only 38, and I was... going a little bit, oh, we're going to be 40. And my wife found the advert for the Jill Edwards course at the Comedia. And she said, you should do this. And I managed to negotiate the time to be able to do it. And it was brilliant. It changed my life. I did it more as a confidence thing.
Yeah.
Because, you know, doing management stuff, you have to kind of speak and do, you know, talks. And I found that very difficult. So I thought, well, this will at least give me this confidence to do it. And plus, I'd always wanted to do stand-up anyway. And then, just went on from there. And then I ended up, left there, and then ended up working various places. Ended up on the London Road. At Poundland, which...
Prepares you for anything.
Oh, my God, yeah.
Yeah.
The last day... This is a true story, right? The last day I was... when I decided I can't do this anymore. And this is absolutely true.
Yeah.
And I know you get comedians go, oh, I'll tell you a true story. And you go, mate, you've made up... This is absolutely true, right? I was in the Poundland store on the London Road, the small one. It's only got two aisles, as you know. And it's 9 o'clock Monday morning. There's me, I'm loading up the crisps, and there's a guy on the till. That's it. That's all the people in the store, right?
Okay. Yeah.
And there's obviously all the thieves as well, but, you know, that goes on. And a woman comes in and she announces she's, like, 20, 25 years old. She is drunk as a skunk, right, OK? And she announces her arrival, right, with, oh, it's Poundland! You know, she is gone, right? And I'm not Sherlock Holmes, but she's with a guy, and he's clearly on drugs, right? Because he's just...
Yes.
Just doing this, right? And but, you know, they both seem to be in a good mood, so who am I to get in the way of their Monday morning revelry?
Exactly,
Not I, right?
Yeah.
They go down the corridor, I can hear them talking. She says the thing that everyone says in Poundland, you've probably said it yourself, you know, oh, wonder how much this is. Oh, hang on, I bet it's a pound.
Yeah, probably have said.
Everyone says that one.
Yeah.
You just hear it all the time. You know?
Yeah.
And she comes round to me where I am, and I'm loading it. She comes up and she goes, excuse me, mate, where's the crisps, right? And I'm like... and she goes, no, mate, where's the Monster Munch? And I go, well, I'm sorry, I'm afraid. Because don't you lie to me. I know you've got the Monster Munch. Where have you hidden the Munch? I mean, she's screaming, she's shouting like nobody's business, right? And I go, whoa, calm down, you know, it's going to be all right. She then starts picking up bags of crisps, chocolate bars, everything. She's just throwing stuff at me, right? And I pull out my phone. I go, you need to stop. I'm going to phone the police, right? She stops dead, right? There's a moment's silence. So you know, like, we've been on the London Road and you have to deal with some, oh, what's going to happen here, right? It was probably just a nanosecond, right? But it felt like an hour. I had long enough to look at the guy who's just doing this, right? And then out of nowhere, she screams, and I won't do it because of the microphone, but she screams, she goes, ah! Paedophile! Ah! She then runs down the entire length of the store screaming, ah, paedophile, ah, paedophile. Comes up the other side. I, of course, just step over the gap, right? Which stopped her dead. You know, it was like, how did you do that? What magic was this, right? She then starts picking up shampoo bottles at me, deodorant cans, absolutely throwing all this stuff at me. Eventually, I corral her out of the store, right, okay? Look at my colleague at the till who's just going, and I look at the people in the queue and I think, oh, well, welcome to the London Road, right? And then I remember the guy, he hasn't left, right?
Yes.
He's still in the building, right? And I think, oh, God, you know, I've got to get rid of this guy now. And I look down the first aisle and he's not there, right? And I look down the other aisle and there he is. He's right down at the end and he's in the book section, right? And he's picked up a book, and I know which one it was because I only put them out that morning, right?
Yeah.
It was these little stubby red Spanish-English dictionaries, right? I know, only a pound.
Yeah.
Anyway, so he's got the book, and I can't see from the angle, but he's got it like this, yeah, right? And it looks like he's trying to inhale the book, right? And I'm thinking, that's not how you learn Spanish.
Exactly.
So I get a bit closer, right? And I can see what, and this is the, absolutely true. He's got the book, right? He has a lighter, right? He is burning the cover of the book because he is smoking heroin off the cover of the book, right? Now, I'm pretty sure I don't want him doing this, right? So I sort of go up to him and, you know, in a very Brighton kind of way, just went, you're right, mate. And he's went, what's the problem? And I said, well, you're smoking a heroin, you're burning a book. You know, outside's fine, you know.
Yeah.
And he was lovely. He said, oh, do you want me to stop? I was like, yeah. He
goes, yeah, exactly.
He goes, oh, I suppose you want me to leave, don't you? I was like, yeah, do you mind? Right? He's like, no. And I know the long-term effects of heroin is just horrific.
Yes.
But quite frankly, as far as his behaviour was concerned, everyone should be on heroin. He was an utter delight, right? Right up to the point where he wanted to take the book with him, right? And I was like, but it's not your book, you haven't paid for it, right?
Yeah.
And I started arguing with him, and I think, what am I doing with my life? I'm 47 years old, I'm reasonably good at talking to people on stage, and yet here I am in a Poundland on the London Road in Brighton having an argument with a drug addict over a £1 Spanish-English dictionary, which is effectively a very, very long-winded way of saying it's really lovely to be here.
Yeah. And so, I mean, it was only a pound. Did he give you a pound?
No, I just let him take the book.
Okay.
I think so. No, I didn't. I had the book for a while just to prove to people that there was this Spanish-English dictionary with a great big burn mark on it.
Yes, yeah.
It was a very odd time.
And that was probably the best way of dealing with that situation, I would say, as well, because it's kind of
there's no
kept
point.
It calm.
I mean, for all the funniness and silliness of the London Road we were talking before, it's just tragic.
Yes,
So, it's just silliness, really.
Yeah.
There's no point in starting a fight because you're not going to win.
Exactly.
They don't even know where they are, really.
Yeah, so that was Pam then. I mean, did you get a lot of material, like, dealing with the general public? Because every day kind of situations with, you know, just everyone, really, the general public, there are moments where you need humour to deal with it.
Exactly. There's all sorts of, you've got to see most stories happen and things happen and then it's afterwards you go, hang on. Like, I was when I ran the garden centre, there was a coffee shop. And this guy came, and he's the most British man I've ever met, you know, real Daily Mail.
Yeah.
And he said, I want to make a complaint. And I was like, oh, what's the problem, sir? You know, he said, it's about your tea for two. I was like, oh, okay, what's the problem? He says, well, the pot of tea, there's only enough cups for three cups in there. I was like, well, how many cups were you expecting? And he said, well, four at least. I was like, but that would be tea for four, wouldn't it? Right? And then afterwards he just went, well, to hell with your maths, and just stormed off. So there's little things like that happen all the time.
And
you just sort of think, oh, OK, that's a good little bit. I can put that in.
Yeah.
And like with most comedians, so anything happens to you, whether it's sort of mildly amusing or thing, or I mean, you can lose a leg. It doesn't matter. If you could get 10 minutes out of it, you're happy. That's the comedian rule.
Yeah. And is that your kind of comedy then, that kind of situation comedy in a way?
Yeah, it's more verging on storytelling kind of thing. So it's more about stuff that's happened to me. It's not, it's not punching out. It's not punching down. It's just basically this has happened and the situations we find ourselves in.
Yeah.
And people can relate to that or they just like listening to me tell how tragic my life is.
So what there's a famous course, isn't there, that people do at the Comedia?
Yeah, Jim Edwards,
What was the kind of the trigger to go there then? Because often you were mulling it, it sounds like. But
well, I'd always wanted to do stand-up. And then it kind of got on the back burner. I tried it once at university, like we all tried one thing at university. I should write that down. That was a disaster. And then it was just this Jill Edwards course, and she's taught everybody from, Jimmy Carr, Sarah Millican, anyone, Sean Walsh, Ramesh Ranganathan. He started with me as well.
Yes.
Whatever happened to him. And
yes.
He's down to his last seven television shows as well. Yeah. Very worried about him.
He's still around just about.
Just about. He's clinging on, bless him.
Yeah.
And it was just this course. And so Jill runs this thing. There's a beginner's course.
Yeah.
And it basically sort of teaches you how to sort of do stand-up. It teaches you the principles.
Yeah.
You write your own material.
Yeah.
But it just gives you an idea delivery. Of how to do it and delivery and the confidence to be able to do it.
Yeah.
And then at the end, if you sort of pass the there's an audition and you could do the gig. They have a big night at the Comedia, where it's on December the 3rd this year, where the new acts come along and they do their 3 minutes that they've learned during the 12 weeks.
Yeah.
So we did all that. I didn't get that part. I didn't get to the stage in the Comedia. So yeah, people do that, and it just changed my life. It was just great. As soon as you start stand-up comedy, it's addictive. You know, your first gig's always great because it always goes a lot better than you expect it would, because you've got visions of people heckling you and all sorts. But really, no one's there to be nasty. Even the audience members, everyone's there because they want you to succeed. No one wants you to fail.
Okay.
Yeah.
We'll leave it there for now. Join us for the second half. We're going to be talking to Aiden about his gigs and about what makes good comedy. So join us for the second half. So I'm here with Aiden Goatley, the comedian. I nearly called you Jen Edwards in as well.
But it's fine.
You went to the Jen Edwards course.
Yes.
Comedian, we were talking about beforehand. So what did you learn from that course? What makes good comedy? Because it's to get good material that really works must take quite a lot of time.
Well, what makes good comedy what makes bad comedy is a lot of new acts thinking that they can be outrageous. Right, and the problem with that is that while we can watch comedians like Frankie Boyle and, you know, comedians who are very edgy, we feel safe with them because we know they're professional.
Yeah.
Right? We know what we're going to get.
Yes, and you shouldn't be listening to them if you...
Yeah, exactly. You just know what's going to happen.
You know what's going to happen.
Exactly,
so there's kind of a...
But when you're in a pub in a gig like that and there's some guy you don't know who the hell he is, right, or her, and she's just going to go, well, I'm going to say what I want to say, outrageous, you know, and it's just not going to work. Because people are going to feel uncomfortable. And then if you say something that makes half the audience uncomfortable, and the other half might find it funny, but the problem is they're going to pick up on the audience and the thing. Now, I'm not saying that all comedy should be just bland, but with the Jill Edwards course, what it does, it gives you an opportunity to actually work out, A, what will work with the general crowd. And then once you learn that, then you can change it. Then you can find your style.
Yeah.
So then you can get out and gig and you can sort of push the boundary. You can push it a little bit.
Yeah.
But then, so that's, I would say that is the most important thing. The number of times you see acts and they're very confident and they're great and they're doing it, but the audience will just shut down.
Yes.
Because they're going, no, okay.
Do you think tastes have changed, haven't they, in recent times? So do people have a right not to be offended, or what should you be offending? Should not you, but should comedians, should people be allowed to offend people? Because this is kind of the key.
I think if you go to a comedy night, I think that you've got to expect that there's going to be acts that you might not like.
Yes.
And that's just how it works, right?
Yeah.
They have absolute right to do that. If it breaks any laws or anything, then obviously not. But if they're just saying something that some people find funny, then you just go, okay, other people find it. It's not for me.
Yes.
And I think that's the thing. That's a key sentence that everyone, I think, needs to know.
Yes.
It's just not for you.
Yes.
You know? I say it often to my wife about my daughter's choice in music. And she goes, I don't understand. It's just not for us.
Yes.
It's okay. Yeah. Do you know what I mean? And I think that's the same with comedy. If you're going to see like a big act, you'll know what they're going to be like, right? So you're fine, you're safe. If you're going to just a comedy night, like with a compendium of acts on, there's going to be one or two on that might not be your cup of tea.
Yeah.
Just deal with it, basically.
Do you think there should be boundaries for comedians then, or not? Or should anything be open to
I think anything's open to thing, but it's all about context.
Yes.
And it's all about intent.
Yes.
If the content and intent are fine,
yes,
then you're okay. Do you know what I mean? If everything's done with the best intention, then it should be okay. There's obviously boundaries. Do you know what I mean? We don't do racism, we don't do sexism.
Yeah.
Easy, don't homophobia, just don't go there.
Yeah.
And then that's fine. Yeah, everything else should be fine.
Yes. Yeah, and can like politics, but it's kind of accepted that politicians kind of accept that they're going to be ridiculed, right? But I mean, it goes with the job, but I mean, sometimes that must be quite difficult.
Politics will split a room completely.
Yes.
Especially the dreaded Brexit word.
Yeah.
I've got one in my last show. I was travelling around all 105 counties to go to the Google centre of each one and ask what makes people happy.
Yeah, exactly.
Right?
Yeah.
And I wanted to completely avoid politics, but I was in Northern Ireland and you could not avoid politics.
Yes.
And all, it's just impossible.
I've been there a few times.
Yeah, it's an amazing place, but at the same time, so absolutely...
You go in a tea shop and, you know...
Oh,
it's
like, and you can feel it, can't you?
Yeah.
But the one gag that I had was that of how insane it is the one point I'm driving along the road and the road was in the UK, right? I pulled into a petrol station and the petrol station was in Europe. And the only reason why I knew this was because all the prices were in euros and everyone was happy.
Yes.
Right? That's the gag. That's it, right? And the room, sometimes you could feel, you know, and that's either people completely disagreeing with my thing about Europe being happy or whatever, or they're getting tense because they think, oh, is he going to talk about Brexit?
Yes.
Now, in my shows, I can understand people doing that because I don't really go political. I don't do anything like that. But in other shows, if you were saying you're watching Frankie Boyle, for example, you go, oh, OK, this is what we're dealing with. You know, he's an established act.
Yes.
I'm not an established act as such as people.
Yes.
So therefore, people will get worried about that.
Yeah. So with your shows then coming up, I mean, what can we expect to see in your shows?
Well, I'm doing a sequel to... I did a show called 10 Films with My Dad. That was the first show I ever did, and that ended up touring all over the world, and that was a story about how me and my dad just watched films, we never talked. Now that she's 15, I'm doing a follow-up show called 10 Films with My Daughter, and it's basically about whether, as a parent, you're going to make the same mistakes as your parent did.
Yes.
And so we're going to go from the 10 films from when we first knew we were going to have the child right up to now. So we got the last film. First film on the list, funny enough, was Batman Begins.
Yeah.
Because we found out we were going to be able to adopt Rosie literally 30 minutes before we went to see Batman Begins. We were scheduled to go and see it. And the last film is Joker, which was her first 15-rated film. She wanted to go and see at the cinema. So it was dutiful parents. We took her to see that.
Yes.
And I'm a bit worried because she laughed the whole way through.
Yeah.
I might be raising a psychopath. Not entirely too sure.
Yeah. What shows are you, you've toured nationally. I know you've been to Dundee, which is interesting.
Dundee's fantastic.
Yes.
Brilliant city. Absolutely adore Dundee.
Yeah.
Very much like a Brighton. There's a lot of stuff going on. But I'm doing a tour of Scotland in April. But locally, I'm in, dare I say, Worthing in February, doing the big show there. I will be at the Brighton Fringe doing 10 Films with My Daughter.
Yeah.
And I've also got the 105 county tour. That's still ongoing as well.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I've got a lot going on.
Yeah. And do you miss any... What you must miss something from you know, your previous career. So what do you miss?
No.
There must be something there.
No, I miss... my blood pressure doesn't miss it at all. My tension
£1
doesn't
after
miss
eight.
At all. £1 clearly my stomach is still not suffering from the lack of food. Do I miss anything from my previous life in retail? To be honest with you, no. I have the greatest sympathy for anyone who does work in retail.
Yeah, it's difficult,
and it's difficult. There's a lot of bullying. There's a lot of basically cost-cutting and therefore treating people like cattle. And it's horrible. I regret nothing. And I'm delighted that I don't have to do it. I mean, I might have to go back to it. You know what I mean? It's nothing's guaranteed. But at the moment, I'm very happy that I don't have to.
Yes. Dealing with the public, that's... I mean, it must have kind of... It must give you a lot of material. Because it's just generally... You just meet a whole wide range of people and...
You meet also, I mean, for example, in the garden centre, my favourite one there was the most Daily Mail man I've ever met in my life. And he came out to me, he goes, I want to make a complaint. And I was like, ooh, OK, what's the problem, sir? And he said, well, I want to complain about your tea for two. I said, OK. He says, well, the pot of tea. He goes, there's only enough cups for three cups in there.
Yeah.
Well, how many cups are you supposed to be, you know, how many were you expecting? He said, well, four at least.
Yeah.
I was like, well, that would be tea for four, wouldn't it? To which his genuine response was, well, to hell with your maths. And then he just stormed off.
Yeah.
And little things like that, yeah. But you get interactions every day, you know, and they can be funny too.
Yeah. Is it what's it like being on the road then? Do you find it quite difficult? I mean, how do you gauge... How do you know from town to town to different? Do you find different jokes work differently in different venues?
Yeah, different things can work. I mean, I was on the Isle of Wight a couple of weeks ago.
And it's a nice place.
It is a lovely place.
Yeah.
Kind of stuck in 1985.
Yes.
But I was doing two shows. I was doing the 10 films of my dad's show, and I was doing another show called The Vicar's Husband, because my wife is training to become a vicar, and I'm an atheist. And so that's quite a good show. However, on the Isle of Wight, don't do religion. Just don't do religion on the Isle of Wight, because they all went like that. So I went, I'll do the film show, and everyone, oh, that's lovely. Yeah, no, it's fine.
You just said your wife's a vicar. I mean,
she's training.
She's on the path.
The technical terminology. She's on the path to possible ordination. Yeah.
But you're an atheist. How does that work? I mean, I can see how it works, but
yeah,
for some people, maybe not.
People do go, when you tell people, go, oh, and they think, no, I'm not about to tell you about the breakup of my marriage. My marriage is very strong because we both believe in Batman.
Yes.
So it's okay.
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
Yeah, it's just, basically the rule of thumb is that the Church of England, which my wife is affiliated to, or afflicted by, I should say, their rule is basically just be lovely and just treat everyone equally and be nice. And I think that with even regards of religion, that's the ethos that everyone should have, is just be lovely. And then everything will kind of work out.
Yes.
Hopefully, if everyone was lovely.
Just before we go, have you got a website?
I barely update it, to be honest with you. I'm on Twitter, at Mr. Aiden Goatley.
Okay.
Is on there. And there's aidengoatley.com. Is the website. On YouTube, if you type in my name, you'll see a lot of my stuff on there.
Thanks for coming in, Aiden.
Thank you.
Been a joy. Cheers. Goodbye,